Yeah, don't get me started on Redo of Healer though. That's one big monster right there. That made Shield Hero look like a joke.
Yeah, if you want halal, you can watch Tonikaku Kawai.
Yes.
The Arab fans call it halal love story. because they begin with marriage.
Oh yeah. This is podcast number 85, Jay Agonoy with Keepsakes. Thank you very much for being with us today on this special episode. We're just 15 episodes shy from having 100 episodes, and joining me until that point, is really much appreciated. So we have our very special guests from Indonesia, our neighboring country. On my left is the senior editor at the Indonesian Anime Times, the English division of Indonesian anime news site, Kauri Nusantara. Ladies and gentlemen, Halimun Muhammad, good evening to you from Manila.
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, so by this time, it's 5:30. We're just closing down in the evening so that I can confidently say selamat malam. Yeah, so we're still at and on my right is a podcaster just like me. He is a Japanese pop culture enthusiast, a podcaster on anime manga podcast Lutok, and a collaboration manager of Ghosties Comic, one of the leading Indonesian internet characters who has just had his debut at the Indonesian Comic Con. So ladies and gentlemen,
yes.
Yeah, say my congratulations to Ghosty for that.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lutfi Suryanda Akmojo is with us as well. Salamat malam. Yeah, I just say
selamat malam.
Salamat malam. All right.
Yes. But actually is evening, so we call it selamat sore, but because it's changing into the night, selamat malam is okay too.
All right. Okay. So it's malam. I've been looking at Indonesia so far as one of the perhaps the biggest contributors of Japanese pop culture content. You have lots of people talking about anime. You have lots of media sites talking about anime. And you even had the cyber press coverage guidelines, something that we don't have here in the Philippines by principle. We have it by ethics. So before we proceed to that, I would like to have each and one of you introduce yourselves, what you do, and how did you get introduced to Japanese pop culture. Let's start with Hal.
Right. So, yeah, what I do related to Japanese pop culture is acting as the senior editor at the Indonesian Anime Times. And basically, I check on my colleagues' works, making sure they are fit to be published. Yeah, sometimes I also write my own columns. And how I got into anime, maybe it's not really typical for Indonesian, but I've been watching anime since I was little. Yeah, just like many other people in here who grew up in the 90s, I watched anime on television. I saw shows like Doraemon, Dragon Ball, Sailor Moon. Yeah, those are very common. To be honest, I used to lost interest in Japanese animation actually around 2005. And it wasn't until it was around 2008. At that time, we were subscribing to a satellite TV provider. And yeah, one day I just randomly saw Animax. I saw Kino's Journey at the time. And the show was unlike anything I had seen at the time. And it made me interested. And because I was tuning into Animax, I also saw their other shows. And from then on, yeah, I also look for more information about anime through internet. Yeah, until, yeah, here I am now.
All right, so that's as far as anime has gotten you so far. So how about Luffy?
So the first contact I'm Luffy Surendratmojo. I'm right now collaboration manager on Ghosties Comic, an Indonesian leading internet cult internet character. We have a VTuber right now, comic, and we also collaborate with many big brands, such as maybe like in Filipinos reader don't know, but we recently collaboration with the Indonesian government of post office. We make a stamp and a postcard in Indonesia, and we already have many collaboration in there. So but before I becoming collaboration manager, I've worked in creative industry in Indonesia along 3 years. In games, comic, and Japanese comic, even Japanese comic too. So, and beforehand, I also am a music editor and a contributor on Kaori Nusantara. But beforehand. And the first time I touch with Japanese anime is like, maybe when I was a little kid, I love very much Web Diver. It's on air on Indonesian television. I mean, so deeply love in Web Diver. I waited the show on TV, but I lost interest on Japanese anime is maybe like 4 or 5 years, and I fall in love again in 2010. Because basically my friends, I sit beside my friends who have a really really otaku. And when I say, oh, you like anime? I didn't like anime. First, I didn't like anime on my junior high school. I hate Japanese culture so much. Like you know, it's like it's kind of like a freaky things. Like you cosplay. Oh my god! Like it's weird. Yeah? And right now I'm cosplaying too. It's maybe like a karma for me.
Yeah. You were yes. You're saying that you were a Ryaju before.
Yes, but I'm already turned into an anime lover's one, and the first contact is the first recontact again with anime is like on Evangelion. I'm very mesmerized with Evangelion and Neon Genesis Evangelion, and yeah, here I am, and I watching Good Gundam, and here I am right now working with Japanese pop culture things.
So that's interesting, really interesting. For someone like you, who doesn't like the culture but eventually got immersed in the culture, so two interesting stories. Just to also to share my history with the Japanese pop culture. We grew up in a time where animes on TV is very popular at that time. The most vivid memory that I had was in 2001 when anime was on prime time. Lupin the Third.
Wow.
Lupin the Third.
Wow.
Was on prime time. And then before the evening news starts at 6, we have Mojako.
Okay. Hi.
Yeah, if you're familiar with Mojako. I think everyone here is very familiar with Mojako, although it's not an anime that's been discussed recently. More people discuss series like Doraemon or I forgot this series, that the name of the series. But it has a kettle in it. It has a kettle. Robot kettle. Yeah.
Ah! Tabutaku!
Nah, yeah, they call it Gadget Boy. It's in the Philippines, it's called Gadget Boy. So, Gadget Boy Kanipan. Yeah. So, and yes, we also grew up in a time where Voltes 5 Daimos, most people older than me grew up on the time where Mazinger Z exists. On my end, I barely know Voltes 5's history in Philippine politics in one way or another. But that's for another story. So, we'll start with the questions that we have prepared. I have prepared for both of you. Hal will talk about historical context, brief history of Japanese pop culture in Indonesia, and Luffy will talk about the contemporary context, So we'll start with Hal first. He will be sharing a presentation with us.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about some history. Actually, I'm not really an expert in this. There are some time periods that I do not know much yet. Still need to do more research on that. But at least I hope I can just give some overview of what has been happening in Indonesia related to the availability and the access of anime and manga in this country. So the 90s, I think, was the important moment for the proliferation of anime and manga in Indonesia. Why is it important? We can look back to the time before that. So actually, before 1989, our country only had one TV station, which was the state-owned public broadcaster, which is TVRI. This station used to have important programs because the funding that they received from the government was limited. Yeah, they didn't have that much resources to make their own programs. So it's cheaper to import foreign programs. Yeah, from what I have read, even during the 70s, TVRI also had already shown animated series from Japan, but I don't know much yet about this topic at the moment. However, during the 80s, because of some policies of the New Order government, the imported programs in TVRI was reduced. And also they made TVRI become dependent on the government. As a result, TVRI during this time was more of a mouthpiece for the government, and the local programs that they made tend to be rather low quality, which was uninteresting for the domestic audience. However, also during the 80s, the urban middle class had grown affluent enough to afford technologies that can bypass these limitations. First, they can use parabola dishes to receive TV broadcast from other countries like Malaysia or Singapore, or even to receive CNN broadcast. And also, they can use video cassettes to circulate foreign movies and TV series. Some Japanese TV shows like Space Sheriff Gavan, Dai Sentai Google 5, or Megaloman were accessed during this period through the use of Betamax tapes. So this situation actually caused some concern from the government, because people are accessing foreign contents outside of their control. But the key moment was when one of Suharto's family was interested to make his own TV station. So they gave permission for the first private-owned TV station in Indonesia, which was RCTI. We call it like that. They began broadcasting in 1989. The consideration, other than because one of Suharto's family wanted it, is it's considered more feasible to control foreign contents if they are shown through official recognized channels rather than through illegal means like the parabola dishes. So following RCTI, other private-owned stations also appeared throughout the 90s. Like there was SCTV that was originally based east side of Java. And then there was TPI, which was which was created by one of Suharto's daughters. Yeah, so these TV stations, they featured many important programs when they began. They include like foreign dramas. Yeah, there are dramas. There were dramas from the US. There were also telenovelas. And there were animated series. Yeah, there were animation from the West. Yeah, like Disney Animation, Warner Brothers Animation, like Tiny Toons, Animaniacs. There were even some Marvel animated series during that time, you know, like Spider-Man, X-Men, and Iron Man. And of course, among them, there were also anime series. And we also had tokusatsu programs. Yeah, that some of the examples I will show later. All of these TV programs, when they were shown in Indonesia, were dubbed with Indonesian language, because the Indonesian language is the only official national language in the country. Yeah, so to be able to be broadcasted here, they need to be dubbed into Indonesian. And then the New Order government fell in 1998. And after that, even more private TV stations were also created. Let me show you a list of some examples of the anime and tokusatsu shows that we used to have in the 90s and the 2000s. And I think I'd like to ask Jay if some of these shows are also shown in the Philippines at some point.
All right then.
Okay, so these were the TV stations that already existed in the 90s. Yeah, some of these shows are shown in the 90s, while some others are shown in the 2000s.
Right.
Okay, certain series like Doraemon had become a long time mainstay. It's still airing even until now. Maybe for the other shows, they have a relatively shorter lifespan.
Yeah, I think I saw Magic Knight Ray Earth right there. It's one of the popular Clamp series prior to Cardcaptor Sakura. And in the Philippines, they actually had the theme song of it, the one song, the first opening song by Naomi Tamura. Someone had it sung in Filipino. Imagine that. That was the time. They call it the golden age of dubbing in the Philippines. So yeah, in Indonesia, was it the same? Did it have the same treatment?
Yeah, actually not just the dialogues of the TV shows, but also during the 90s, many of these shows had their opening songs in Indonesian. And yeah, because of that, many of the songs are still remain popular for people who grew up during that time. Like the Doraemon song, people young and old can sing the Indonesian version. And
nice.
Then the Sailor Moon
Sailor
theme song was also dubbed. And
I believe it's also okay.
I think there are still many who remember some parts of the Indonesian version of the song. And also Dragon Ball.
Right. Okay. I look at I look at SCTV. You have Samurai X. We had that aired English lang English dub version and the Filipino language version. I believe that's the English language version is the one dubbed. Produced by Sony Pictures Television. Popolocro, I remember it aired in the Philippines as well. Sakura Wars, I'm not sure. Maybe I could ask others. But Makibao actually aired on Channel 5 in around like the thousands. Tokyo Mew Mew, I'm surprised that you had successfully aired Tokyo Mew Mew in Indonesia. Considering the fact that it has fan service. Right? Yeah. I believe it has fan service.
It was aired in Indonesia, but But unfortunately, I didn't watch Tokyo Mew Mew while it was airing. Maybe some of my colleagues who have actually seen during its broadcast would understand it better. Yeah, but I knew that it did air in a terrestrial TV here.
Beyblade is all...
Yes, that much that I know.
Beyblade. that Beyblade,
yeah,
that
even
one right
some,
there.
Even some toy franchises were... Even some toy franchises were also shown here. And like this Crash Gear, even until now, there is
Crash
still
Gear.
A fan community of of the toy.
Like in the Philippines,
yeah.
We still have
even
our own Tamiya community.
They... Oh, Tamiya, yeah.
Tamiya 4-wheel drive, right?
I think, I think they still have like the circuits in some places. Like I think Manga 2 still had the, yeah, sometimes still had Tamiya events, but I don't know what's the situation now because of the pandemic. So maybe the mall cannot help the event like usual. But I need to look more into that. Yeah, okay, so these are the TV stations that already existed in the 90s. As I said before, after the New Order government ended, there were new TV stations appearing in the 2000s, and they also had anime and tokusatsu, mainly anime, as part of their programming. Yeah. Okay, so these are some shows that were shown in these three stations that debuted in the 2000s.
Yu Yu Hakusho, Cowboy Bebop, yeah, Hunter Hunter, maybe... Slam Dunk, Full Metal Panic. And then Hikaru no Go, I remember it aired on Channel 11 here, when it was not yet a news station. Kuro-chan and Crayon Shin-chan aired on time slots close to each other. Fruits Basket, I remember watching that. Evangelion, they say that it has been aired in the Philippines before. Idaten Jump, I remember that as well. DNA Angel is good. All right, iShield 21, Death Note, and then Naruto, especially Naruto. All right, okay, we can proceed to
yeah,
the next.
Especially remembered.
Yes.
Especially remembered watching Kuro-chan, Binku, Trigun, Jubei-chan, and Tobi Isami. Yeah, but maybe for some others, they were shown during the time when I was losing interest, so I didn't remember that well about them. Yeah, so these TV stations did not exist in vacuum. Yeah, there were other media that supported them, like we used to have children magazines like Bobo that had articles on the children TV shows that are shown in these stations. Yeah. So next, I'm going to show some examples of past Bobo articles to see like what kind of shows they used to feature in their magazines. Yeah, I happen to still have some of the old Bobo magazines from the 90s and early 2000s. Yeah, so
okay.
This was from March 1995 edition. I think mostly here are Western TV dramas. Yeah, but we have Power Rangers here.
Nice.
Yeah. So during the 90s, Power Rangers was, I think it was more known than Sentai. Yeah. But these days, I think people know well enough about Sentai as well. Yeah. Then like we had Kamen Rider. We used to call them Ksatria Baja Hitam because they had black armor. This was about the last episode. And then, yeah, we used to have Astro Boy as well. And here, he even got the machine gun butt. Yeah. Seems it was aired on SCTV. Yeah, and other than TV shows, we also used to have the official merchandise. So Bobo was published by the Compass Gramedia Group, which was the big media conglomerate here. And it seems some of these products, merchandise were also distributed by one of their companies. Yeah, like we have this. I used to have this mask actually.
If I read it correctly, when they say gratis, it's free.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a bonus for toddler milk. I was about 3 years old during this time, so like my mother used to buy me this milk. And I got the mask as the bonus.
Nice. And this one is Indosia.
And this one from 96. Yeah.
Okay.
So as you can see, we also had Western animation like Darkwing Duck, along with anime series like Dragon Ball, Sailor Moon. And we had Superhuman Samurai Cyber Squad.
Okay. Superhuman.
Yeah, we actually had
SSS before Gridman. This is before Gridman, right?
This was the US adaptation of Gridman, but the US version was shown here before Gridman. Gridman came later.
Oh.
That's an interesting part. Okay, and then, we had... This is Magic Knight, Ray Earth. Side by side with Spider-Man. And it's funny that RCTI used to show Metal there, and then after it finished, it showed VR Troopers.
VR Troopers, yes.
Which, as you know, it used the Metal there suit.
Ah, yes.
Along
yes.
with the I think it was the Spielband suit. Okay, so they aired the Japanese original and then the Saban version, was it?
The Saban, yes. The Saban version.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And then, and this was around 2000 and 2001. Yeah, we began to have Digimon and Pokemon as well. Yeah, and around 2003, they had article about Tamiya circuits, like the variants. And then here, there's the football series shoot, but for football anime, the one that's most remembered by local fans was Captain Tsubasa.
Yes, Captain Tsubasa.
Yeah, but they didn't have the magazine that talk about them, unfortunately. Okay. There were some ads, including for the comics.
Metabots.
The snack had Metabot.
Metabots.
Bonus with them. I like to watch that series during early 2000s. And then this was
Disney.
The most new that I had. They reported about Animax.
And you had Kim Possible on Disney Channel. I remember watching Kim Possible when we had cable at that time. And Jimmy Neutron. All right.
Yeah. Okay, so I think you can see that historically, anime did not come to Indonesia on their own. It was part of the general trend of showing foreign TV shows during that time. And there are other medias like magazines that support by providing information about these shows. Okay, so we have been talking about the anime side. Now I'd like to talk about the manga side. And just like anime, the important moment also came in the 90s. There were people who said that manga actually already entered Indonesia before the 90s, but I still didn't know much yet about those early manga. But in the 90s, the important development was there was a big publisher that became the dominant the dominant licensor of manga in Indonesia. So we had LX Media Komputindo. Yeah, this company was also part of the Kompas Gramedia Group that I mentioned earlier. They were originally a publisher of IT books, yeah, just like the name suggests. The computer was a new thing in the 80s, so they published book about computers. In the late 80s, one of Kompas Gramedia's founder became interested in manga. And he offered LX Media to publish the manga because Gramedia's comic publishing unit was already busy publishing European comics at the time. Yeah, they had European comics and also Hong Kong comics, I think. So it was offered to LX Media, and yeah, they took the offer. And in, I think it was in 1989 that they published Candy Candy. That was the first manga they published. So they began actually with a shoujo manga. Yeah, following that, they also published, they published more manga. Yeah, they actually published Akira quite early. And then Doraemon became one of their most important titles. And they had, in Indonesia, the manga was published as Kung Fu Boy. The original title was Tekken Chinmi. It's still one of the more popular titles that LX Media published, even until today. Then they also had Dragon Ball, Detective Conan, and many others after that. Now the important point is, because they began to grow as a manga publisher in the 90s, yeah, there are a number of their popular manga that also had the anime shown on TV, yeah, like Doraemon, Dragon Ball, Sailor Moon, Detective Conan. Yeah, these books also had the anime on TV. So it's likely that the manga and the anime, even if the publisher and the TV stations did not always cooperate with each other, but the existence of both, I think, promoted each other. And then it's not just LX Media, actually. Yeah, other publishing units of Kompas Gramedia also has been publishing manga, especially one of their units called MNC. I think it was originally short for magazine and comics. Yeah, so they also had manga. They also has manga as well. Yeah, one of the interesting things about these companies, they actually sister companies, but they can be quite often compete to get licenses for the manga. And somehow MNC has gained a reputation for publishing shoujo manga, while LX may be more known for publishing shonen manga. But of course, it's not always like that. Yeah. LX actually began by publishing shoujo manga, and they still have shoujo manga to these days. While on the other hand, MNC also has shonen manga. Yeah, like some of the more popular titles of recent times are Haikyuu and My Hero Academia. Yeah, both of those series were published by MNC. Okay, so now let's get into more details about how they have been publishing manga in Indonesia. So for a long time, the comic books had been printed on cheap paper. That way, they can keep the cost of the books very low. I think for a long time, we can say that the books cost less than $2 each usually. And then yeah, during the 90s, Alex particularly changed the books into using Western binding, so the books can be read from left to right, unlike the Japanese original, which was read from, which are read from right to left. Yeah, the concern was because most books published in Indonesia are read from left to right. Yeah, maybe it might, it could be confusing to readers if they release books that are read from right to left. Okay, and then they used to have standardized covers, especially for LX publications. I will show you some of the examples later. And yeah, sometimes they featured some localized contents. Like one of the popular, one of the more well-known case of localization was a story in Doraemon, where Nobita used Doraemon's gadget to practice running long distance. And in Indonesian, it was localized into running to Surabaya. As you know, it's one of the major cities in the on the east side of Java Island. So I don't know, I think the original one was running to Okinawa perhaps, but yeah, they changed it into Surabaya.
Surabaya.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that was in the past. Yeah. That was in the past. They did that kind of localization less these days, because yeah, more people are already aware that these are Japanese comics, yeah, and with the internet, yeah, people can learn more about Japan and their culture by just looking them by themselves. Yeah, so over time, some things have changed. One of the important changes was when Alex published the manga of Samurai X. This was the first series that they published with the original Japanese binding, so they were read right to left. Yeah, the reason was because of some requirements from the author. Yeah, there were some skepticism at the time whether people would accept to read something from right to left. But turned out the manga was quite successful. The sales was quite successful here. So since that time, Alex has been publishing new mangas using the original Japanese bindings. Yeah, only some long-running series like Detective Conan that still use the Western binding to maintain consistency. And then Alex has stopped using standardized covers. Yeah. Nowadays, they have more varied covers, more similar to the original versions. And over time, Alex and MNC has introduced labels for mature rated comics. Yeah, yeah, so it was Alex who first started creating the label. It was called Level Comics. So what they mean by mature is actually more because, yeah, the considerations include the violent content, or yeah, because the storyline is considered too complicated to be understood by children. Mm. Yeah, so yeah, so it's less about having sexual contents, but more about yeah, the stories are more serious and complicated. And the MNC has recently followed suit by making their own label, Akasha. Prior to that, for mature rated comics, they just slapped an age rating on the cover, yeah, like 17 plus, kind of like that. Mm. But now both of them has their own specific labels for these mature comics. Okay, and then this is also another important development that has been going on recently. Yeah, they have been making book paper. They have been using book paper more commonly now. So this paper is more higher quality than what they usually used. And the cost is higher, but the demand for using this paper is also growing. So it seems the readers have been ready to accept more expensive manga. Yeah, in the past, the consumers usually are very sensitive about price changes. Even using the cheap paper, the price has increased many times. Like one of the older comics that I have was priced at 6,000 rupiah. These days, comic books that printed on this kind of paper cost about maybe 28,000 rupiah or 30,000. While for books printed on book paper, they can cost at least 40,000 rupiah. But still, in general, manga are cheap in Indonesia. Even with the book paper, overall the price are still less than $5 for a single volume. Yeah, so manga are still more or less affordable form of entertainment. Yes, so I'm going to show you some examples of the changes that has occurred. A comparison for the manga that use Western binding. Yeah, this is Detective Conan and one of the earlier volumes. It's read from left to right, just like many other books that printed with Latin letters. Yeah, well, this one is Kekaishi from around 2010s, already using the Japanese binding. Yeah, you read them from right to left. And then for the changes about the cover. Yeah, they used to make the cover more standardized like this. They have the blue band on top with the publisher's name, and then the title. The artwork is mostly in a box in the lower part. And the author's name was not written on the front cover. They're written on the spine and also on the copyright pages. Yeah, but they stopped doing this around the 2000s. Yeah, now the covers are more varied. They resemble the original covers more. Of course, we have the author's names. This time also on the front cover. Okay, and these books also contain advertisement for other books. Okay, these are some of the older advertisements from 1996. Yeah, so we can also see some other titles that they used to publish. Yeah, this Boy Action 2 was actually, but they changed the name because it has the same artist with another manga that Alex used to publish. And then also around the 2000s, Alex used to publish localized versions of Japanese manga magazines. Yeah, this one is an ad for Shonen Mags, which contain manga from Kodansha's Shonen Magazine, Shonen Magazine family especially. And they also used to have Shonen Star, which carried comics from Shogakukan's Shonen Sunday family.
Mm.
And there were also local versions of Nakayoshi and Hakusensha's Hanayume and Lala. Yeah, so I think there were two shonen magazines and two shoujo magazines. Yeah, but all of the magazines have been discontinued now because yeah, consumers still prefer to buy the collected volumes, the tankobons. Yeah, so here are the titles that are popular in Indonesia. Like Doraemon is of course very well known. Detective Conan is still one of Alex's longest running titles, and it's still one of their best sellers. And we have Kung Fu Boy or Tekeng Chingmi that I mentioned earlier. Yeah, Naruto and its successor series Boruto, they were also best sellers. And One Piece, although coming later than some of the other titles, are also quite popular. While from MNC, one of their best-selling title was one of their best-selling title is Hai Miko or Kochi Muite Miko. So these two series are interesting because they are more popular in Indonesia than in their own home country.
Mm-hmm.
The original title is Tekeng Chingmi.
Mm.
This one is Kochi Muite Miko.
Yep. All right.
Also, some other titles that are that sells quite well recently include like Attack on Titan, One Punch Man, My Hero Academia, and for MNC also like Haikyuu and Tokyo Ghoul are some of the better performing titles. And here you can also see some photos that I have taken from bookshops during the time when I still like going there. I haven't been going to a bookshop for at least a year, I think, because of the pandemic. So currently I'm buying comic books through online shops. Yeah, but usually for new releases, they just pile together the book like this. When they just enter their stock, and yeah, popular titles like One Piece usually have their own shelves filled with the same books. And here we have some examples of titles that are published in the Level Comics label. Yeah, like we have this one is Hajime no Ippo, if I'm not mistaken. There's Karakuri Circus, Kagisanke no Bento. Yeah, for Level Comics, one of their legendary title was 20th Century Boys. Yeah, they published all of them. And yeah, these are the more recent editions of Doraemon. They're still in print and already using a new style of covers. Yeah, so those are more or less the history that has been going on for anime and manga through the official channels in the 90s and in the 2000s. Yeah, throughout the 2000s, the access to anime especially has been more diversified. There are more ways to watch anime, not just from terrestrial TV, especially since they have less anime. They gradually have less anime. I think because the TV stations have more resources now, they can produce more local contents on their own. And also there is a regulation that give quota on how much foreign contents are allowed to be shown by domestic TV channels. Okay, so these are some different means of access that I have identified. Okay, first, there were home video. The Betamax tapes of the 80s have fallen out of use in the 90s mostly. So in the late 90s and early 2000s, it's more common to find anime on VCDs. Yeah? There were official legal VCDs, but there were also pirated VCDs. And after DVDs became the norm, DVDs are more commonly used. But for DVDs, I think the market is mainly for pirated versions. Yeah, there are many vendors selling pirated DVDs in shopping malls, on street sides, near train stations. It had pirated DVDs of Hollywood movies, anime, and many other foreign media. And then there were, of course, also subscription TV. Like Animax is one of the older ones. I told you I got back to anime through watching Animax. And the Aniplus, I think it came later. But throughout the 2000s and 2010s, one of the more dominant means of access was through piracy. For internet piracy, during the 2000s, the internet connection was still not that good enough for streaming. Yeah, so maybe people prefer more to download or to torrent the files so that they can watch the shows offline. Yeah, but illegal streaming already began in the 2000s, and YouTube was actually one of the platforms used for that. But during that time, YouTube was still having a limit on the length of the video. So the pirated anime on YouTube in the 2000s were usually broken into several parts. Like one episode could be broken into three parts. Sometimes it could be disheartening to look for anime on YouTube at that time, to find that not all the episodes are still complete. Maybe some parts are missing. Okay, and in Indonesia itself, fan subs also grew. They sub the anime into Indonesian language. So I didn't participate that much in the fan sub culture, so I couldn't explain that much about this. Maybe some other staff in Kaori know better about the history for fan subs. They did exist, and there were quite many who prefer to use the Indonesian fan subs, maybe because the language is more familiar. Okay, and then, as I have said before, because internet service was very bad, was still very bad in the 2000s, it's very challenging to get anime on your own. So to get more anime, people usually share files with their friends. Or internet cafes, where you can rent a computer to use the internet, also became an important source of pirated contents. There's even a moniker for the generation of anime fans who got into anime by getting their contents through net cafe, like generasi warnet, kind of like that. Okay, and because of these factors, my college roughly has argued that this piracy has contributed to the formation of anime fan communities. Because to get more anime, you need to be in contact with other people. And through that contact, communities grew out of that. Yeah, that's what roughly argued, more or less. Okay, and then another means that came a bit more later was showing anime films through the cinema. One of the important factors that allow more anime films to be shown in cinema has been the introduction of new cinema chains. In the past, Cinema 21 kind of monopolized the cinema network, but now there are more competitors like Blitz Megaplex, which now became CGV, and also Cinemax, which has changed into Cinepolis. These chains gave more spaces for Asian films and, of course, including Japanese films. And outside of regular screenings on the cinema, we've also had various film festivals that show Japanese films. In 2013, there was a one-time event called J-Impact. It seems that they were trying to test the waters for showing Japanese films at the time. But since 2015, we regularly have JFF, the Japanese Film Festival, that is organized by Japan Foundation. Sometimes anime are included in their film lineup. And it's good to have these film festivals because they often shows films that maybe are more commercially risky if shown for regular screenings. And there are also some other forms of non-commercial screenings, like Japan Foundation sometimes held their own small-scale screenings, maybe for films of Makoto Shinkai, or there were also some live-action films that they screened recently. And then after a history of piracy, lately we are having more options for legal streaming. Like, of course, we have Netflix. There are also some lesser known services like Sushiroll or TrueID, which is showing some old shows like Digimon or Magical Doremi. There was Ponimu, who tried to provide Indonesian language streaming service for a while. So their streaming platform has been discontinued. I think they are more active in licensing currently. And what's getting more attention in the past year especially has been news and anyone who streams their shows on YouTube. So it's kind of amusing for me personally to return to YouTube to watch anime after in the late 2000s I've been watching anime illegally on YouTube that were broken into three parts per episode.
Parts, for example, the part 1, 3, part 2, 3, and then those are like 15 minutes or 7.
They're usually about 7 or 8 minutes per part. Okay, but now we can watch anime in YouTube and it's legal. It's not illegal like in the past.
Yes.
So it's kind of amusing to get back to that. Okay, other than this new means of access, of course the legacy means also still exist. We still have anime shown on domestic TV station like Doraemon or Naruto, they had a long-lasting popularity. But the channel that has been gaining attention recently has been RTV. And they started airing around 2014. Yeah, among fans of Japanese culture, yeah, they became known for showing tokusatsu shows like various Ultraman. They've also been getting into Kamen Rider and Sentai. And they also show some children anime like, they've been showing Beyblade, but the more recent version. So we got Beyblade again.
And I believe
of course, the more surprising.
Yeah, I was supposed to talk about RTV airing Anime Yell.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's one of their more surprising recent addition. They've been showing Anime Yell since late January. Yeah. And also some older shows have also, maybe not necessarily old, but they're related to old franchises. Yeah, Detective Conan has been returning to Indonesian TV. It was shown on NET. Also, there has been other stations like RCTI who has been showing like Dragon Ball Super or the David production version of Captain Tsubasa. Yeah, so they bringing back new versions of old anime titles that the 90s generation were familiar with. And speaking of Detective Conan, during the time while it was not airing on TV, the movies were regularly shown on cinemas, especially after 2014, I think. Yeah, so every year, the Detective Conan movies have been shown in local cinemas. And usually the fan club of Detective Conan held held gathering to watch the movies together with their members. Yeah, the gathering has been held in many cities, including in Greater Jakarta, of course. Yeah, but they have also been held in other major cities in Indonesia. Yeah, so here are just some examples of the VCDs that used to be released in Indonesia. Yeah, these are all official, they're legal. Each disc maybe only contain like 2 or 3 episodes, so it's quite difficult to get the complete show this way. Okay, so I think that's all that I can give for the historical background.
All right, so that is Halimun Muhammad's presentation. And on this moment, I will now turn the floor over to Luffy, who is with us right now. So, yeah, going back to the question, contemporary context. What? Yes. So since Hal discussed in brief the moments of Japanese culture in Indonesia, okay, let's proceed with the current timeline right now. So, what do you think are the significant developments for Japanese pop culture in Indonesia?
It's been a lot. I think it's been a lot. It's like for first, maybe thank you for Halimun for the presentation. It gives me a lot of maybe like moment like when I didn't know that Petri Gramedia, the one of the subsidiary of Kompas Gramedia, has a license on every Dragon Ball franchise in Indonesia for printed edition. I just know because I check on the Bobo magazines and the Gramedia had hold so many license, not only the comic but all of the printed edition of anything that Dragon Ball's on it. That's interesting. So, in current timeline, there's so many exciting and I think like when I first time go into the Japanese pop culture, things like going to the event, going to the offline event, going to the Japanese pop culture event, like we have a big one called Anichi Sai in here, and like Komifuro, Comic Comic Frontier is one of the biggest name hold here. And Anime Festival Asia, especially AFA in 2013, is like a biggest, and also Miku Expo 2 is like the one of the biggest major chains. It's like maybe like a cultural zeitgeist, I think, in Indonesian Japanese pop culture community. And it shaped very, and thanks to the internet, the culture, the Japanese pop culture in Indonesia is very fast right now. It's very diverse right now. And people only just enjoy the TV things such as Detective Conan or maybe Naruto in the past. But thanks to the internet and thanks to the speed of the internet too, we can choose all of the title that we want. But back in that time, in maybe like in 2010 and maybe 2011, we can only choose title that popular on forum, just like K-On! Or maybe Haruhi.
Yes.
Maybe like some of Lucky Star but it's only because it famous on forum, so it can be watched. And right now you can freely choose all the title that you want, like thanks to the Netflix and maybe like such as there's much over the top OTT platform in Indonesia, that streaming service. Even YouTube itself, thanks to Muse Indonesia, offered the free anime and Iki to like man, there's so many. I can watch a seasonal anime, 20 of them, all of them, and it didn't possible in 2010. And that's the anime side though, and the manga side, it's very wow, thanks to the pandemic too, all of the people, all of the digital content is like raking up right now. Recently, one of the manga, one of the application built by Shueisha, the maker of Shonen Jump and everything that that your favorite comic will do, the publisher of it. Recently, make manga plus the free manga reading by Shueisha, Indonesia edition. Yes,
we already have titles in Indonesian.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Can you discuss more about the titles that are available on Manga Plus in Indonesian?
Yes. There's a Black Clover, One Piece, Kaiju number 8 or Kaiju Haji, and Spy X Family.
Spy Family. Too. Oh my.
Yes, it's in Indonesia too. And the funny thing is maybe people think like they really simultaneously on behalf of the publisher in Indonesia, but actually Shueisha commish of one of the translator group in Indonesia, and they give a mandate to translate it. So maybe people like, oh, this is like a publisher content. No, it's very own Shueisha content, not Indonesian publisher content. Mm-hmm. So it's maybe like it's direct from Japan, like literally direct from Japan, without single-handedly the help of publisher Indonesia.
So that's interesting. On yes. The manga side, okay, I would like to also stick this in about idols. Idols. So from your record, from your account, Luffy, when did this idol craze start? So we're very familiar with the AKB48 system. We have our own MNL48. You have your own JKT. We call it MNL, you call it JKT.
Yes. But the idol culture is very hot. But in 2012 and 2000 and maybe like 2017, it's very hot in Indonesia. But right now it's like a very declining state right now because of this COVID-19 too, and maybe all or maybe like 50% of the JKT48 member have now graduated.
Oh.
Yes, because of the operational cost and the other things like that, and
they don't even hold auditions. So far.
Yes, no audition because
no election. Oh.
Yes, only just graduation though, because you know it's very hard time to theater to still open up, because you know the charging fee of the venue is very very high, and yeah, basically it's just not good situation for JKT48 right now. But in the past, like maybe 8 years, 9 years ago, perhaps it's very very big time for them, because they got supported a lot for in conventional media in Indonesia, especially television. They got a star on their own soap opera, maybe called Sinetron in here, maybe like in drama. Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, in drama here, and they've got a lot coverage. But you know, they right now only has a famous on social media platform right now, like just like an Instagram influencer or Twitter influencer right now. Not so much appearing of TV anymore. Idol Crazy is like boom, but you know, maybe like people like changing to the virtual idol right now, like whole life, who call themselves an idol YouTuber, but not really. Yeah, people get into the virtual, into that, but most of the virtual idol lovers is maybe like an animal lovers before, while the idol lovers is basically just like a boy or maybe a man who loves a woman, and that's it. A normies can enter idol fandom, but only an anime otaku can answer a virtual idol fandom.
Oh, so that's how it looks like in Indonesia, it seems. So, okay, because I've also seen some posts on Instagram while also searching. By the way, I got introduced to the Indonesia, the Japanese pop culture in Indonesia, to one of his name is. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it was through his blog. I should have remembered the name at this moment. Golly, Ahotako 39. Yeah, that's it. Ahotako 39. That introduced me to the culture in Indonesia, where it said that in cosplay you should not have the same costume. You should not meet together, or else it's taboo. And I've also seen like. Cover groups of Aqua or JKT, AKB. Yes. So, yeah, so I get a glimpse that, again, as much as parallel as we are in the Philippines, this is why I consider the Philippines and Indonesia are close neighbors. Regardless of the faith, we have a good following of Japanese pop culture. Even if the Philippines is flooded with all the K-pop and the army, and that it's fine. But at one time, Sweet Soul Review was one of the popular songs here, and it's still being played here on radio for some time. And how should I describe it? We had our own edition of like VR Troopers. If US has VR Troopers, and then Indonesia has Bima Satria Garuda, we have Zaido. Of course, we the Filipinos are not forgiving when it comes to the adaptations. As much as the people, as much as Japanese pop culture fans were not forgiving with the adaptation of Dragon Ball Evolution.
Yes.
So yeah, but I believe Bima Satria Garuda, which is an original in Indonesia, produced by Japanese producers, was so popular it had a second season. And the fact that our brands have been into Indonesia, like Rappler, Itbulaga. Rappler, Itbulaga. So that's why it opened my mind to the fact that maybe one day I can go visit Indonesia, but then the pandemic happened. Which is quite sad. So with that said, I'll put forward this question. What have you observed so far in the community today? So, Luffy, you talk about virtual YouTubers, the HoloLive ones, the Mahapancha, the Nijisandi Indonesia. So, Hal, what is your perspective on the community today? Aside from the ones you mentioned earlier.
About the community?
Yeah, about the community. How is it surviving in this pandemic, perhaps?
Or the general trend... I think from what I have observed in the 2010s, mainly, is that the community has been growing to become a more segmented. So like they're more focused on specific franchises that they like. They gather together with fans of the same franchises. Like maybe you can get the Idol Master.
Idol Master. Clubs,
or yeah, the Love Live fan clubs. Mm-hmm. You know, like that. While for surviving in the pandemic, in the past year, we have seen some attempts to create online events. Like one of the more attention-grabbing situation was when there was a Facebook group where the members role play as if they were visiting an actual offline
yes.
event.
Yes. It really brings back memories.
So there have been various efforts to try to hold online version of events to reproduce the experience through various online channels, yeah, maybe on Facebook or through Discord. Like there have been some Kaori staff who have been observing some kind of like online doujin event on Discord. Yeah, so that's what I've been observing so far.
Okay, so like in the other countries, you are transitioning to online events. So Kaori is still basically covering this stuff. If I'm not mistaken, my first Indonesian event was Creator Super Stream. The second one.
Okay.
Yeah. So
the second one.
So it rings a bell. It rings a bell. Right. So yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's the first time perhaps that I've seen Nijisanji ID and Hololive ID and then Mahapancha. I hope I pronounced that right, because Zen Gunawan is going to guest. Mahapancha Zen Gunawan is going to guest for Domo Ariga Thanks a day after this recording. But yeah, moving forward to that, I think the Indonesian pop culture, more as far as I see it, it now discuss more things related to VTubers.
Yes.
So, really interesting times, and you know, it's I'm at a loss of words with how great select Indonesian VTubers are. I can name two: Risu and Hana Makia. Risu and Hana Makia. You know, these two virtual YouTubers, setting aside the others, they really define to me what VTubers in Indonesia are, which is great and which is wonderful. So I guess before we proceed to more VTuber talks, I would like to first thank you both for joining us here. But I'm not sure if I'm going to ask this question, because again, I said earlier, there are many media entities in Indonesia. We have Nawala Karsa, Kaori Nusantara, we have Japanese Station, we have just how many of you, and how and Risa Media, yeah. So
yes.
So in that sense, how do you meet before this pandemic? How do you even meet each other? How do you mingle with each other? You're so many. How's it? So let's take it from the position of you, Hal. So do you meet your colleagues in the other media entities in Indonesia?
For the Japanese culture media, there is actually kind of like a group where representatives from each of the media to communicate in there, but not all of the staff of our media joined in that group. Yeah. There's a representative who yeah, who would relay the information, and maybe from there. Yeah. Well, other than that, yeah, sometimes we did meet the staff from other media during events like Comic Frontier or AFA. Yeah, so those are the places where we, yeah, kind of can meet.
And these events, I really miss going to these events, because if you have the same experience as I had, then it's really, really, right? Really, really, like, I really miss going to these
really,
events.
Really, really, really.
Mingle with colleagues, fans, people from other media. You see, there's not that much activity in the Philippines when it comes to online events. Really. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
Yes, I miss do that one too, because, you know, an event, especially Japanese pop culture, even Indonesia, is kind of like melting pot in Indonesia, where you can meet all of your colleges and all of your maybe like Japanese anime fans. But recently, when I go to the last Komifuro, Comic Frontier, it's like a 2020, February 2020. It's like exact last year before the shitstorm happened. and the interesting thing is this event, this Japanese pop culture event, it's not only to meet one of your colleagues or on one of your friends that who loves anime on internet, on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. No, the normies people start swarming this event too. The funny thing is, because, you know, like Comic Frontier here, Komifuro is like maybe like 10,000 people in 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't get advertising a lot. It didn't get promoted a lot on maybe many major news channel. And people like kind of it's like on went viral on internet, on social media especially. And it's kind of like a melting pot. I remember that I've got my friends who working in music label Indonesia. I met him and I asked, why you come to the Komifuro? Oh, I'm just accompanying my wife to sell her design on this Comic Frontier. How the sales good? Yes, it's good. Comic Frontier is very, very good for selling your design, selling your aesthetic and anime design. And my wife loves that. I can like, wow, a normies like him enjoy Comic Frontier. This is must be something, right, in Indonesia?
Yeah, that family factor, I think, play an important role. I think the visitors quite largely driven by young fans, teenagers, and especially when we talk about teenagers, they usually come to the. Yeah, they maybe need to come to such an event with the accompaniment of their parents. Yeah, like I teach in an English course, and yeah. One day while I was teaching the student for a writing lesson, yeah, one of the students who is still a teenager actually wrote about Komifuro for the assignment.
And how young was how young? Yes. How young?
Yeah, wow, okay.
I think it's in junior high school.
Junior high school. Right. I think the common audience. I think the common audience for the anime community starts at the time when they enter high school, or not as far as elementary, grade 6, starting from that, and then high school. Is it the same in your area? Is it the same in yours?
When I was
maybe like in my area is like maybe if you say six is.
6 years old.
No, yes, it's maybe like six, maybe like on, maybe like, you know, 6 years old. I just remember on NHSI last year, I have cosplay as Izuku Midoriya as Boku no Hero Academia.
Yeah.
I've cosplay as Deku. And 5 year old kid knows the character. Like, wow. Because, you know, my Hero Academia, that time, Hero Academia didn't show on the TV, right? Before it show on national TV, and the 5-year-old kids know about it. So
whoa,
wow, yes, maybe Halimun Said, maybe like since he teacher, maybe like he observed the student, maybe.
Yeah, of course. I've seen students with anime stickers on their phones. And yeah, like My Hero Academia stickers, or even now when we need to teach online, of course I've had students who use anime pictures for their profile pictures. Like and there were those who use pictures from Bungo Stray Dogs, Hanako-kun. Yeah, at one time I've even seen one student in my class who brought a paper,
okay,
with the runes from the Madoka Magica series.
Whoa!
I don't know if she was learning how to write that.
Whoa! That is something. I've never had that experience. I've never seen anyone write in runes. Maybe it's just me, but to hear that from you, that's not really the big impact of anime.
It's more of a printout actually. But I don't know why she bring that printout to the class. I just need to tell you that I teach mainly in the junior high and high school level, so I don't know that much about the elementary school level.
Yes. Right.
But it's quite something, you know, it's like junior high school and he swallowing Madoka Magica. Oh my God. I bet in the near future he's getting slice of life anime, right? Yeah, like maybe a simple thing, because you know in junior high school, oh my God, I've consumed too much edgy anime.
Yes. So if you've consumed so much edge, you'd rather want to have slice of life. On my end, I'd still prefer slice of life over everything. Yeah, don't get me started on Redo of Healer though. That's one big monster right there. That made Shield Hero look like a joke. But yes, it's basically how do I call it? It's haram. It's not allowed. Something like that. that's forbidden material. I don't know. So yeah.
Yeah, if you want halal, you can watch Tonikaku Kawai.
Yes. I think that is also halal. That's halal.
The Arab fans call it halal love story. because they begin with marriage.
Marriage. Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, can I ask some questions maybe?
Yeah. You can ask me questions.
Jay. Yeah. As I have explained, in Indonesia, we got TV stations quite late. But from what I have read, the Philippines actually already have various TV stations much earlier than Indonesia. So how do you think that might affect the way anime was introduced to the country?
I think the turning point of anime in the Philippines was in the 70s when GMA Network had aired Voltes 5 here. And since I mentioned that it went political, simply because the story of Voltes 5 is about rebellion or liberation and all that, and how these things work. At the time, it's 1970s, martial law in the Philippines. So the story goes like this: when your media is controlled and your Voltes 5 is taken off the air by the government simply because it promotes rebellion, imagine Voltes 5. While I believe it did not have much of an effect in the start of the uprising, the first quarter storms, the rallies. As far as I see it, But the assassination of one of our senators at that time, Benigno Aquino, was a main turning point. But that's for another story for the EDSA Revolution of the 1986. Anime in the 90s went as perhaps I'm not born in like the 80s, but around the let's say 90s, they call it the golden age of dubbing for animation, not just anime, cartoons as well. If I vaguely understood it, that was a time when the series were still dubbed locally in English, and then we eventually transitioned to dubbing it in Filipino around the 90s. So when I say Magic Knight Rayearth and the theme song was in Filipino at that time, that was one. So to answer your question, anime so far, the TV networks, we had a TV station as far as 1953, and yeah. So far there's only cartoons. I'm not sure, but when we talk about anime, it's around the 90s up to like the 2010s is when I started realizing that I have an anime crush by the name of Mai Tokiha, and this was from a series called Maihime, which was aired on Channel 5, on TV5, the new TV5, because it was just reformatted. And the series aired alongside Code Geass, Special A-Class, and Toradora, and Shakugan no Shana.
It's on terrestrial TV channel, not on cable TV.
Yes, terrestrial TV. At that time, that reformed TV5 is a trailblazer. It started the anime trend. It made people want to watch anime again. And it's on prime time, competing with the news time of the main TV stations, Channel 2 and Channel 7, the GMA Network, and then the now, ABS-CBN, which I believe it has hit you as well. ABS-CBN has lost its franchise just recently.
Your TV show coaches on the prime time. Even it's Japan, and it's in Japan, it's not shown on prime time.
Well, they have, of course, there are regulations, there are censors. But anime, TV5's Anime Mega Block was again a trailblazer. They even had a weekend marathon of Maihime, starting from like 5 to 7, or 3 to 4. Maihime, yes, Maihime of what? All the series. Aside from that, Maihime Special A, Code Geass. Well, you can call Maihime haram for all the good reasons.
My Philippines TV is so wild.
Yes. And then you call it conservative. And then you can call us conservatives.
Actually,
what the hell? Oh my God.
Actually only saw Maihime on DVD.
Yeah.
I imported it. I imported it actually, and I still have the DVD.
Nice.
But it's interesting that... it's interesting that you have locally produced English dubs, yeah? Because if it's Indonesia, of course, all of the animes shown on TV are dubbed just into Indonesian.
Yes.
There's no English.
Yes.
Yeah, so I guess that's because for the Philippines, you have both the Filipino and English as your official languages.
Actually, Filipino is our national language, but we grew up, you know, being conquered by the Spaniards for 300 years, being conquered by the Americans for the next few years or so. Of course, then World War II, and then so on and so forth.
Yeah.
So, but we grew up in the 70s, grew up speaking in, having their broadcasts in English. You know, when the popular 70s series were being aired on Channel 9. Channel 9 was the big one way back then. And it has a pretty big margin. What I'm saying is Channel 9 way back then was the home of popular dramas and all that, and then mismanagement happened, and eventually 2021 CNN Philippines Ring a bell? Seen in Philippines and seen in Indonesia. I believe these are the first local CNNs CNN had. Yeah, we have CNN in the Philippines. And it's on free TV, not cable, not just cable.
Yeah.
In Indonesia, CNN in Indonesia on cable TV, not on terrestrial TV.
Ah, okay. But I believe you have. But I believe CNN Indonesia programs are jumping to terrestrial TV as well. Some of it, yes.
Yeah.
And then we had Rapper in Indonesia.
It was kind of like syndicated to a local station. So the condition is kind of different with Indonesia because I think the U.S. Did invest on public education in the Philippines using English language. While our colonizer, the Dutch, they didn't teach Dutch to Muslim.
They basically didn't care about us.
Usually only the elites who need to do their business with the Dutch who understand that. So because of that, the Dutch language is pretty much forgotten in a couple of decades. And we just speak Indonesian outside of our own local languages, of course.
Yes.
And to think that you also have your own local languages, of which I ask, how many?
It's a lot.
We have many dialects in the Philippines as well, from north to south.
There are hundreds.
Yeah, I think we need a proper. Do we even need a proper comparison for that? Let's just say we have many dialects, and the Filipino is the national language, the identity of the Philippines, and then Bahasa Indonesia is the national identity of the national language, the identity of the Republic of Indonesia. We're both republics, by the way.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's pretty similar on that regard.
Mm.
Difference is just we do not have English as we do not have English as widespread as in the Philippines.
I see. So
yeah, you also mentioned about the regulations like censorship.
Yes, regulations. We have.
Do you have any information about how that works? Yeah.
In the Philippines, we have the Movie Television Review and Classification Board. The MTRCB. Yes. So when you if you still have parabola antennas or parabola dishes that's connected to the Philippines, maybe you can hear the five tones. Tan 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 tan. Okay, maybe a pitch higher. That's the the new regulation was introduced somewhere around the 2010s, before 2010s.
Okay.
And it's PG, that's parental guidance. And then the G, the general patronage, and then the strong parental guidance, which is to us, it's a funny meme, but it's a serious regulation. But sometimes we think of SPG as a funny meme, because
but the censor in the Philippines are extreme, like in Indonesia, because you know in Indonesia the censor extreme, like. They can cut your story. They can cut the anime story. I just remember watching Boku no Hero Academia as a fan of My Hero Academia. Watch it on Indonesian television, RTV. They cut all the All Might smashing the enemy. Like, what? It's the essential of Hero Aka plot. All Might smashing the enemy and they cut it. It's on the Philippines. The censorship is extreme like that.
I believe not, but. And as far as I remember, there was this. Let me try to remember what happened to some of the titles that are aired on TV5 at that time.
Like Codius, maybe like Codius, like you know, Codius have many fan service characters and many fan service. So maybe they left.
It could be it could be a combination of white, or it could be if it has blood on it. Black and white.
Ah, same as Indonesia.
Yeah.
My Hime
was not that. I don't think My Hime has shown the. I think My Hime was also trimmed down. As far as I can see it. I also believe that in some cases, my because the, I watched the rest of the show online. That's where I got introduced to Dimay Nakahara. Dimay Nakahara. You know, aka Reina Ryugu. So yeah, but really, I see, perhaps I'm not that much into anime on TV way back then. But when I watch, I watch. So I watching perhaps of course I got interested in the voice acting industry of the Philippines. That's where I got to know the likes of Mary Grace Cornell. I was able to meet her in person and ask for her autograph. I still have it on my records. So yeah, so that's a voice act. That's just one part. That's just one part. And then we have like voice coaches. I believe nowadays they're still doing their voice coaching lessons, some of them. So yeah, that's as far. I went too far from talking about My Hime, if it's a censorship. But of course, censors, cuss words being muted out on movies. And if it again, if it has themes, language, violence, sex, horror, or drugs, it will be automatically put into rated SPG, because that's the six. That's the six ones that will be placed. So, I will share you a clip of the MTRCB ratings, so that you can be familiar, and then we can exchange some. Because do you have like PG ratings in Indonesia? Do you have like something like that?
Yeah, there is something like that. Like SU, semua umur is for all ages. BO is bimbingan orang tua or parental guidance. Yeah, but in your country, they call it the classification board. Is that right?
Yes, the MTRCB, the classification board, including movies.
What we have here, yeah, what we have here, is actually called the censorship board.
Hmm. So I think from one of the screenshots I see, there's this RBO. So that's
it's complex thing. RBO, it's like for teenagers, but with parental guidance. It's like basically it's like 16 plus on maybe like in the US US rating, because I think like
only.
RBO itself, yes, for teenagers but with parental guidance. I think it's like kind of awkward, because in Indonesia we have R rating, not the R rated one, the violence one, but R for remaja or teenager. And yes, and they change it to RBO, remaja bimbingan orang tua, teenagers with parental guidance. Like I kind of don't get it. Teenagers want to be rebel of all they watch and all they hear and all they look, but they need parental guidance to watch TV.
I think that's the reason why they need to. Because if you say that they want to rebel, then as a conservative myself, sorta.
Yeah.
Sorta. Well, I think
The censorship board, their jurisdiction is over things shown on TV and also on cinema. Yeah.
Cinemas.
But we also have another body, which is the Broadcasting Commission.
Mm.
Yeah, their jurisdiction include TV, but not cinema.
Mm.
Yeah, they work more on the post broadcasting end. So they may receive complaints from viewers after the show has been broadcasted. They also observe the shows that are being broadcasted by themselves. Yeah, so on the source side, yeah, we have the censorship. We have the censorship bureau. They may cut the content that deemed inappropriate. And then after it's broadcasted, it's still observed by the Broadcasting Commission.
I see. Do you also have like something similar to an ad council for advertisements, for billboards, for commercials?
In Indonesia, we call it PPPI, Persatuan Periklanan, the Advertising Board, but it didn't it didn't help much, and in this context it didn't involve in anything in on TV or cinema. They're just basically just like a union of the advertising company in Indonesia.
Ah, okay, so it's like a self-regulated organization.
Yes.
Ah.
To some extent, a censorship also present in the comic books, because they need to comply with of the regulations.
Hmm.
But the level of censorship can vary. Like if I see the manga released by Alex, I think they're pretty loose with swimsuits. What I see most notable to get censored was for bath scenes, especially when they are not wearing any clothes.
Hmm.
Usually it's blurred, kind of like that.
Ah, okay.
And I'm sure it's the lack of clothing that is the consideration.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is also another scene that take place in a bath,
mm-hmm.
but it doesn't seem to be censored because the characters are wearing swimsuits.
I've got sorry about this.
Yeah, but
and
for
it's
MNC, the case.
Mm-hmm.
For MNC, the case is a bit different, especially for My Hero Academia. Like in an earlier volume, Momo's costume was censored. But in a later volume, the censor was only on the cover, while the content is not censored.
Okay.
It's kind of the treatment was kind of different in many ways.
Mm, I see. So
while for TV, I think what they cut most often, especially for action series like Hero Academia or the Kamen Rider that has been shown on RTV, are the scenes where the punch or the kicks hit another character.
So they it's mostly the fist fights and the injuries that are cut as whole.
But funnily enough, RTV actually uploaded some of their shows to YouTube.
Mm.
We can watch them for free there.
Mm. Including
the
scenes.
And the shows that they put on YouTube are not censored. They're the full episodes.
Okay. But it's only available in Indonesia, right?
Yes. Yeah, only in Indonesia.
And it's not regulated by the regulation. It's not regulated by the censorship board.
Yeah. I think YouTube is outlined of... I think YouTube is outside of the regulations.
Yes.
But not all of the shows are put on YouTube. They mainly put up their tokusatsu shows and the children cartoons. I have not seen them uploaded the Hero Academia yet. Maybe it's because of different licensor.
I've got a story about the censorship manga, especially manga in Indonesia, especially My Hero Academia, since it's my favorite franchise right now, one of the best favorite manga that I've follow on. This is the story of censorship itself on the back of the cover on the volume 1 of My Hero Academia in Indonesia. First, they didn't censor Midnight. They show Midnight with the, Midnight, that character that have a boobs, and the boobs are open, and when the parents see that on the bookstore, he complained to MNC, and this is the story coming from my college, my friends working on MNC. He's an editor of My Hero Academia. He said, like, what the hell is this? This is a blasphemy. How can you dare to show this into my child? And afterward, My Hero Academia was censored on the cover, but on the cover, and the inside it's not that censored. It's like, maybe it's like a trickery to maybe like, because you know, parents, oh my god, this is a safe content. Okay, I will buy for you. Maybe just like that. They're smart for triggering some censoring like that.
No, that's a funny story. But, all right, so aside from Midnight, Have they censored any other characters aside from Momo and Midnight?
Especially, I think it's the cover that may draw attention. Though on the other hand, I think I need to look more into that. Those are the most notable, really.
Meanwhile, in the Philippines,
the cover, especially drawing attention.
All right, okay.
So on the other hand, Alex has been publishing Hayate the Combat Butler. Yeah, even though the cover has swimsuits, yeah, they just put it like that.
Hayate, all right. They're still publishing it.
No complaints so far.
They're still publishing it until now, no?
It's already finished. They're publishing Tonika Kotawai now.
That's why we got introduced to the halal love story.
Yes.
yeah.
It's marriage story, but on anime steroids.
Okay, in the Philippines we had this we had Kodansha titles translated localized in the Filipino context, but not into the point that Okinawa is going to be replaced by Surabaya. We had Fairy Tail and Attack on Titan in Filipino as manga. It was an effort by Kodansha through one of the local media giants, Viva, to distribute those titles. And as far prior to this conversation, I've talked to people who have seen it before. It stayed for 20 chapters and then it discontinued, so we don't see the light of day, unfortunately.
Wow.
So this is why
Attack on Titan
and Fairy Tail in Filipino manga with the cheap paper style and all, it didn't continue to be, how do I say it? It just didn't finish distribution. So it's a sad moment. And it was distributed.
But is it the kind?
It was distributed on the.
Is it the kind of?
Yeah. Go.
Is it the kind of manga sign in Filipinos are declining, or the physical?
I'm not sure with the physical, but if we talk about manga, I think much people are more interested in reading manga in English. Because I don't see Filipino language manga. It was an effort to bring the manga into the mainstream, but unfortunately, it didn't last. Yon. That's a key. That's a keyword. It didn't last enough to have. It has an audience. Like Fairy Tail I believe Fairy Tail was airing on local TV at that time, but not Attack on Titan. But Attack on Titan is good.
Yes. It's kind of interesting thing, right? The English version is sold like maybe like a cake, and the Filipino version, it's not.
Yes, right? As far as I see, maybe during their heydays, it's distributed well because it's distributed in the largest bookstore chain in the country, national.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, it stayed for after 20 chapters. So I think I as much as I want to think that the audience is not used to that, companies set the trends. Maybe there's something wrong with how it was distributed and all, if it was properly promoted and all. Unlike in Indonesia, you only have like the Compass Gramedia Group, and you're basically they're also partnering with local entities. You also have that those kinds of like X deals here, but I don't think it succeeded in its goal. So yeah, that's a sad story in our turf.
Wow.
Yeah, I think for in Indonesia, the Indonesian edition of the mangas do not really compete that much with English editions. Yeah. Again, because English is not really that familiar among the Indonesians. So I think there are so many people who are still more comfortable reading in Indonesian. And the importing manga from English language can be quite costly here. So not many people can do it.
And interestingly, in Indonesia too, there's maybe like some disruptive maybe like some disrupting physical media, because you know Manga Plus is already make a big move to make a content on Indonesian language, and it's a big name. One Piece, Black Clover, Spy Family, and Kaiju number 8 is pretty viral in the Indonesian manga reader, and they kind of like disrupt that. I don't know. The disruption is maybe in from physical to digital in Indonesia. Maybe can take very very long, because you know people still wants physical copy of the manga. And Gramedia.com, the online store of Gramedia Bookstore, our major bookstore in Indonesia, has maybe like discount. Maybe they're investing on discounting their manga. Like you can maybe like buy the newest manga on 30-second discount price right now to more people to buy the physical things to compete with maybe like their own their Japanese publisher Shueisha to compete with it, because you know maybe like in the future the disruption, it's kind of very interesting as people, we don't know the pandemic last, and maybe like people wants to read digital rather than physical and going to the bookstore. But I don't know, it's not there yet, but it's maybe take a long time in Indonesia.
Okay, so we've talked about anime, we've talked about manga. It's pretty, I'm pretty happy to, you know, loss of words. It's really great to talk about anime and manga and Japanese pop culture with you two. Unfortunately, we have to rest at this juncture, at this moment, because you know, this whole night of discussing, maybe we can have a part two of this. Yes. Would it be okay to you if I invite you again for another part?
Yes, of course.
And everything will be about VTubers. Is that okay for you?
I think I'll have someone else who can speak better about that.
All right. Okay. So, yes, I think we'll have to wrap up this episode. And again, thank you very much, Halimun Muhammad of the Indonesian Anime Times and Lutfi Suryanda at Mojo of Loot Talk. And please promote your sites, starting with you, Hal.
Okay. For the Indonesian Anime Times, you can open it at Kaori Nusantara. Okay, for the Indonesian Anime Times, you can visit our site at kaorinusantara.or.id/English. We also have social media on Facebook and Twitter at ID Anime Times, without any spaces, and all of them lowercase. We have news about new licenses in Indonesia, and also some news about Indonesia's own popular culture, like local games, local comics. And yeah, we have features like reviews, analysis, interviews. Those are for the more general content.
All right, so thank you very much. And we go back to Luffy. So how do we reach you?
Okay, you can follow me on Instagram, maybe like Instagram Lutfi Suryanda, or maybe you can add my Facebook, Lutfi Suryanda at Mojo. And maybe I'm on podcast on Loot Talk, but on Loot Talk, I only speak Indonesian only. So if you want to see my English speaking interview, you can check me on Creative Disc. There's some interview with international artists that you can watch, and I'm not only that anime things, but I'm also music journalist. So, and don't forget to like Ghosties Comic. That's it, because you know, maybe after this I will start writing in English and maybe doing podcast in English. this is the first time I'm recording podcast with English language. I collaborate podcast with English language, right?
Yeah, maybe you can try that, because again, the global podcast audience is big, and one of your colleagues, I'm not sure, his name is Ehi. He and AT, both of them have this podcast called Virtually Talking. It's all about VTubers. I'm sharing that here right now, guys. So yeah.
So maybe the next podcast, Jay, we can talk further about VTubers community in Indonesia because you know it's like it's kind of wild, like it's literally wild.
Right? It's really wild, right?
Yes. As a manager of VTubers too, there's a lot of to share too.
All right. With that said, it's nighttime. So how do you say thank you and good night in Indonesian, in Bahasa Indonesia?
In Indonesia?
Yeah. So thank you and good night. How do I say that?
Oh, we say terima kasih and selamat malam. Terima kasih for thank you and selamat malam is for good night.
All right, thank you very much. Terima kasih, selamat malam. This has been episode 85 of Keepsakes the Podcast.
Selamat jai.
Okay.
Thank you.
See you later. See you next time.
Next time.